Amen. Thank you so much. It's so good to be in the house of the Lord this morning. It's so good to see everybody. Well, I'm Pastor Mike, and hey, it's just, once again, good to be here today. I want to say a big thank you to everybody who helped us with Summer Splash. In fact, we have a little slideshow just to roll while we're doing announcements this morning. It's going to be behind me pretty soon here. Hey, that was a pretty neat event, and we had all sorts of things going on. All sorts of kids running around, getting wet, and we just had a good time of outreach and fellowship, and just testifying to our community around us as people drove by and saw us with the signs and everything like that. And the thing about kingdom spreading, you know, Jesus talked about faith like seed being scattered, and it's going to be very frustrating because you don't actually see the seed germinate, right? You don't really see it grow in the soil, and it takes a long time. And yet we read the passage about how God makes it grow. So we're just thankful that everything we do is 110% in the gospel way, that we are doing what we're called to do. And hey, we're just proud and happy to share it. So go ahead and enjoy that there. Hey, you might have seen on the loop board in the email news as well, we have a school supply drive going on throughout this month. And we'll collect the supplies throughout the month. That actually was not said yet, so it'll be throughout the month. And there's that box in the foyer if you want to drop off some of those supplies. The principal, our school counselor over there at Southwood Elementary, actually told us, hey, let's do the drive for the teachers. Many of you may know that teachers often have to buy their own supplies. And so this is something very helpful, very beneficial. So we're just happy to do that and bless folks. So. Hey, another special announcement. Jackie James is going to do the rest of the announcements today, and we might see Jackie doing a few more of the announcements in coming Sundays. So I am personally very thankful for that, so why don't we give a round of applause to Jackie.
Good morning.
Good morning.
I think you guys are actually awake. So our first announcement is a prayer request with Christmas going out in the evening news. Tim Hill, a former long-time attender, is asking for prayers for a successful surgery and recovery. She's having a spinal fusion process called a TLIF, and it's this Wednesday, August 3rd. She has a compressed nerve running from her back down to her toe. It looks like the recovery is between 12 and 16 weeks, so she would appreciate all of our prayers. So that's August 3rd. Make sure you guys keep her in mind. This Saturday, August 6th, we are having our Seismic Shock event. We're going to have a movie night. We're actually going to have it in here. And I think we're watching Night at the Museum. So that'll be fun. So we're going to have popcorn and candy and all of the good stuff that comes with movies. And then also, the first and third Wednesdays, we're going to be doing Seismic Shock on Sundays from 6 to 8. So basically, everything new is going to be 6 to 8. That way you don't have to remember what time it is. 6 to 8. And then Faith Promise is actually right around the corner. It's Labor Day weekend, this Saturday night and Sunday morning. And we're looking forward to an awesome event. There's more information on that loop board that's out in the hallway about our special guest, the Mantuel's missionary family. You can expect a special service and a special time of worship through music and updates on our church's global mission events. We want to put together a potluck, so if you guys would, there's a sign-up sheet out on that table, if you will sign up on that to bring it in. This event is going to be just as amazing as last year, if not even better. So if you guys will pray with me, we'll get started. Lord Jesus, you are worthy of our honor and our praise. Please help us to love you and do and act wisely as you do to show your love through us and bring people closer to you. May we build each other up and encourage each other today as we give you all the glory. Amen.
Good morning, Southwood. It is good to see you all today, and I'm just thrilled to be here as the worship leader. Would you stand this morning and please open with the Psalm scripture, leading into our first song? From Psalms 107, verses 1 through 3, it says, "Give thanks to the Lord, for he is good. His love endures forever. Let the redeemed of the Lord tell their story. Those he redeemed from the hand of the foe. Those he gathered from the lands, from the east and west, from the north and south. Give thanks to the Lord, for he is good. His love endures forever." Amen.
Mm-hmm.
Psalms chapter 86, verses 8 through 10. In the King James Version, it says, "Among the gods there is none like unto thee. O Lord, neither are there any works like unto thy works. All nations whom thou hast made shall come and worship before thee, O Lord, and shall glorify thy name. For thou art great and doest wondrous things. Thou art God alone. How great thou art. O Lord,
I'm praying.
ministers forward. How great is our God? Amen? We really do serve an awesome God, and I hope we don't ever get tired of Him. You know, He has new morning mercies for us. Every day, He has new blessings for us. So this is the time we set aside just to worship through giving. Lord Jesus, we thank You so much for who You are. We thank You that You give of Your very self. Help us just to understand even a small portion of what that means, Lord. Help us to be thankful and not get caught up in all the complaints and all the woes and all the whining that we tend to do, especially when we're tired. But Lord, help us to remember how abundantly blessed we really are because of You. Bless the gift and the giver this morning. It's in Jesus' name we pray and ask these things. God's people say, amen. Thank you.
Thank you.
hymn. It's the song that says, "Let God, let Jesus be the King of my heart." And at the end of the day, that's what all this is really about. You know, does Jesus rule my heart? Is he Lord of my life? We can get tangled up in so many different things, it's just wild. At the end of the day, does Jesus sit on the throne of my heart? That is what matters. Is he directing my actions and my attitudes, my behaviors? Well, it's a time we set aside during every service called family prayer time where we pray together as a family. And it's a time that we encourage one another to lift each other up in prayer. You know, because the truth really is that, hey, times can be good for a lot of different reasons. But people are hurting. People are struggling. People are getting moved in and out of hospital care, in and out of rehab care. Even people that we know and love, long-time attenders. The Bible calls us to be people of prayer. Jesus taught us how to pray. So that needs to be something that defines us as a people. So I just invite us all during this time, why don't we set aside this time and just pray together? That's just who we are and what we do. So Jesus, we come before you during this time just with a humble attitude. Lord, we realize that you call us to prayer and to be a praying people. It doesn't have to get more complicated than that. That we are simply following you and what you instruct us to do. Lord, we know it's not about our own power, our own strength accomplishing this, God, but hey, we just give it to you in this moment, Lord. And we lift up people we know are struggling during this time, are hurting during this time. We think about Brother Shelf. We just ask for your special healing touch upon him, Lord Jesus. We think of many others, God, as we have this prayer list that goes out on a weekly basis. And it seems like every time there's a praise report, there's another prayer request coming in. So, Lord, we just lift up our brothers and sisters. Some of us are going through cancer treatments. Some of us are going through different sorts of rehabilitation. Lord, you know, and you are King. We ask that you be King in my heart, in our hearts. That you be King of this place in your church. May we be a community of prayerful people, praying for one another, and just doing not random acts of kindness, but because you have moved us to do it, that we do surprise each other just with your kindness. Thank you, Jesus, for who you are. Lord, we sometimes get trapped in a Christian bubble, Lord, but we also understand that our community, our society, our nation, it's a hurting and hurt place. And we see it all the time, all over the news, how hurting people hurt people. Lord, we just pray for this nation. We pray for our leaders. We pray they would make godly decisions, Lord. We remember your scripture that instructs us to do that very thing. Lord, we know that if our leaders put you first in every decision, things would look different. So, Lord, we just ask and pray for this umbrella of your divine guidance, your protection, your wisdom. May it just saturate us as a country, as a community, as a church. Can you be King of our hearts starting today? Maybe it's for the very first time. Maybe it's coming back to what the heart of worship is really all about. Lord, we're going to thank you for what you do during this service. And we're going to praise you for what you do, because you really are good. So good, Lord. Thank you, Jesus, for who you are. It's in Jesus' name we pray, and God's people say, amen. Well, friends, you have made it to the final day of July. It has been a long, hot month. And today, I'm wrapping up this summer series we've been doing on listening and loving. Listening and loving. In our world today, you know, I got to just turn off the news sometimes. Because if I watch the news too much, I start to get depressed. We live in a world filled with violence, filled with wars, even just unkind acts towards one another. And you hear about those things. In the Church of Jesus Christ, we must face this crisis of listening and loving. We must be representatives of the gospel. We must be speaking life. We must be sharing support with words and actions, encouraging each other in a common mission, a mission together, something that unifies us. Around here, we have a motto, it's loving God, loving people. So last week, we focused on listening and loving with words. Simply by speaking, we can completely change, you know, somebody's life. But one thing about words is that, well, if our words do not align with our actions, they're not commensurate with our character, well, then we begin to have a different sort of problem, don't we? We might have an integrity problem. We might have an hypocrisy problem. So today, on this last message in this series, it's one more teaching from Scripture on this theme, listening and loving, and it really rounds out the Bible's instruction on this all-important topic. I mean, can anybody really argue against this idea that we need to be better at listening and loving? It's a short verse, but it's a clear teaching. It comes from 1 John chapter 3, verse 18. It's just one verse, and it's a command. I tell you, it's rich with gospel truth. 1 John 3:18 says the following, "Dear children, let us not love with words or speech, but with actions and in truth." The word of the Lord. Jesus, we thank you for your mighty, powerful word. We thank you that through your word, your Spirit works, that even an imperfect vessel can communicate the words of Scripture brokenly, but that you are powerful to work through your Spirit in the hearts of people, to change minds, to save lives, and to bring the gospel's glorious light. Lord, help us not to take it for granted the power of your word. Help us to hone in on it. Help us to focus on it. Help us to quiet our minds and just still our psyches. Help us forget about other things that so easily distract. Help us just focus on what your word is saying, what you have for us, not the pastor, not the worship songs, but Lord, what you have for us today. Help us to tune into that. Help us to listen to you and love you. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, the question I want to start us off with today is, have you ever wanted an affirming word from somebody? And I know you have. Because it's true for everybody. In fact, there are boys and girls who grow up to be men and women who still hurt by this very thing today. There are people who just never heard mom say it. There are people who never heard dad say it. Your teacher might have said it. Your pastor might have said it. Your coach, your manager, your counselor. But you know what? I'm proud of you, son. I love you, my daughter, no matter what. These just mean something deeper when dad or mom say it from the heart. When dad says it from the heart. When mom finally means it. You know, we move beyond words or speech, like our passage is getting at, and into deeper truth, into actions commensurate with love. Past, present, and future. Maybe you're someone today who's hurting for these words, who's hungry for these listening and loving words. Maybe you're someone who needs to give these words to somebody who's hurting. Maybe all of us are called to love with actions and in truth that accompany our words. That's really what the passage is getting about. Our passage today, it comes from the book of 1 John. You know, somebody once asked me, "Pastor, I'm really struggling and I'm depressed. Is there just this book that you can recommend to me that would really help me out?" And you know what I said? I said, read the book of 1 John. 1 John. 1 John in the Bible, that is a special book. It is a unique book. If you're a note taker, you may want to note this because, well, Pastor, how can you say it's a special book? Aren't all the books of the Bible inspired of God? Well, yes, but, hey, just read it yourself. Just take a look at it. I can almost promise you that if you're in a place of hurt and you turn to 1 John, you're going to walk away a different person. The Lord will work something in you through the words of 1 John. I'd like to start with some Bible background just to get us started. So early Christian tradition ascribes authorship of 1 John to, well, you might have guessed it, John, the old disciple. And it's possible that John gains the nickname Elder, as he's called in 2 and 3 John, because of his age, but Elder also because of his stage, his reputation in the church. 1 John was written sometime between 85 and 100 AD. So all the original disciples of Jesus have now passed on, except for John, the Elder. Yeah, the son of Zebedee, brother of James, the son of thunder. This is John. The only surviving witness in this intimately close association with Jesus himself. In fact, he is the lone survivor at this point of the upper room. No, not finding Jesus. And this is just one example, right? John was there for everything. So when John says something, his age, at his stage, you know, it is different from when just anybody says it. Our first takeaway this morning is the following. We must speak in loving ways, and ways to love will follow. I apologize if it's washing out up there for you. We can see in this takeaway, it's a missional takeaway, right? In this passage, the point is not that talk is cheap. The point is not, you know, never use words, but that pathways open to show love, with actions after words, after W-O-R-D, afterwards. The point, again, not never use words, but speak in loving ways, and speak in loving ways firstly, primarily, and often. And once you do, I can promise you, Jesus will begin to show you how to act afterwards, act out his love. You can check out Ephesians 2:10 for more about that. Before moving on, I would like to, in fact, show you something incredible pertaining to this takeaway because, well, somehow I've observed in my short life that we can get bored or we can get trapped in a Christian bubble and we kind of blaze on by certain scriptures sometimes. This especially happens in the beginning of many of the New Testament letters. But there is this little diamond here in the rough, you know, and it's just sparkling. I mean, it's really bright for us to see it if we just know it's there. So, listen to this. 1 John 3:18, he starts off, "Dear children, let us not love," and he says, "Dear children." That's the part we kind of breeze on by. But when we stop and we all realize who the elder John is, and not only who he is, but who he's writing to, this takes on a new meaning. I mean, hey, this was the guy called the Son of Thunder. This was the guy who wanted to call down fire from heaven. He was mistaken about all sorts of things in his past. Well, I'd like to tell you about John's original audience. You see, the honeymoon was over, and it would have been very easy to panic at this point. 2 or 3 generations passed since the birth of the Christian movement and that day of Pentecost in Acts chapter 2. And it became clear that these new ideas that were wrong began to be introduced, which could undermine the heart of this loving community. And that's what it was, the early church, a loving community. And this is just a generation or two within Jesus' resurrection and his ascension. New generations of children were entering the church. They became less connected with the original disciples' well, they're direct eyewitnessing of Jesus' life and miracles and crucifixion and resurrection, ascension. Everything they heard, well, it was now second or third hand. And so these ideas began to surface, you know, these errant doctrines taking shape, and they were striking against the very heart of the movement. And what made it all the more tragic was, this problem in John's day, it arose not from those who came from without, but from within the church. Now, concept, the punch here, the bite of this, is John, the oldest original disciple, speaking to these dividers. I mean, this is not good stuff. These schismatics, even. He's not speaking to them, as he's justified to do so, in a condescending way when he says, dear children. And he's not demeaning them, as the Son of Thunder may have done. You know, he's not raining down thunder from the sky. In love, what does he say? Dear children. And we can be sure that this dear children means something deeper. Because not just anybody, but the elder is speaking it. And what follows, and throughout this letter in John, 2nd and 3rd John, are ways to love. Actions to love. That's our takeaway. Ways to love will follow when you speak in loving ways. Here's the relevance. You know, I hope we all see just how important this really is, and for a variety of reasons, for our unity in the mission of Jesus altogether. Differences of opinion, they arise, and they often result in conflict and division, right? And this can happen in our marriages, in our families, at work, and in the church. But John gives us a model for dealing with sensitive issues. There's hope. There's encouragement in John. He addresses them with endearing terms rather than insulting them. He says, my dear children. In fact, he goes on, even in our passage, he's specific in criticism. He doesn't level base insults, you know, at somebody's character or somebody's intelligence. He's emphasizing teamwork. He's complimentary throughout the letter, which softens his later strong admonitions. He challenges people to trust Jesus all throughout. He gives them assurance, and they know this is someone who practices what they preach. This is John the Elder. And that's what this really boils down to. Are we people that practice what we preach? Maybe you're in conflict with someone right now. Maybe someone, rightfully so, needs a word of correction from you. Use loving language, period. This is my next takeaway for today. Well, it's the world that is the focus of loving concern. Yeah, it is the world that is the focus of loving concern. This point may sound obvious, but it's actually a little bit confusing. Another way to say this is that when it comes to our listening and loving problem, well, the world is where and to whom we show love. This is the definition, in fact, of the phrase the world when we find it in the Bible. It is the people to whom we are called in the places and situations which need the gospel of Jesus Christ, which, by the way, includes all of us. This is the focus. And by the way, the world also includes an appropriate aspect of environmentalism to an appropriate extent. God created the world, and He loves it. Well, the world is the focus of loving concern, because the end result without Jesus, well, it's despair and violence. A little more Bible background for you. Hey, we must all remind ourselves when we're looking at the Bible that 1 John is not written to or for people outside the church. And that's an interesting thought. Because I'm pretty sure we all know a time, or we've heard of one, where the Bible was kind of used in such a way to thump somebody outside the church. But not a single Bible verse was written for people outside the faith. And that's quite shocking to hear. All of it is addressed to God's people. It's all addressed to God's people. That's who John is addressing. Well, but Pastor, how could you say that? What about people have to hear the gospel to be saved? You know, what about handing out Bibles and all that good stuff? Well, yeah, that's great. I know the Spirit of Jesus works through testimony, works through Scripture. But we need to go and tell how Jesus changed our life. And we can, yes, use the words of Scripture, speaking in loving ways, and do commensurate actions, not going out and condemning. But would Jesus do? What would John the Elder do? Well, the issue is the world is not supposed to be something that we're running away from, hiding from, or even trying to destroy because we're convinced it's totally unsavable. You know? And you will find many people get like this because of sin, in a nutshell. People become very jaded. People become very cynical. You know, I hate people. I don't want to be around people. This world is so evil. And this is not encouraging at all. And it's not the view of Scripture. It's not what John the Elder would embrace. It's a kind of bitterness. It's more than a personality thing. It's a kind of bitterness that can come, that creeps its way into our worldview, and it begins to inform the kind of teaching. This is what's going on in 1 John, the teaching even in our churches. And it's this deep kind of pessimism where sin in our hearts has unseated the power of grace. And it's trying to set itself up as more powerful than grace. And it's totally untrue. And this kind of thinking, this kind of attitude, hey, this is alive and well behind people, for example, I mean, come on, who perpetuate school shootings, you know, mass murder, and all sorts of violence. Well, I know it's complex, but this is a big deal. This kind of pessimism is a big deal. And John, Jesus, God's Holy Spirit has nourishment for us, for his mission, and brings us up out of the pit. So the point is, we're to be spending our time exercising loving language and actions in the world. Sharing Jesus, not focused on condemning. My last point for you is an attempt to capture everything and sum it up. If we act lovingly and we speak in truth about Jesus, well, things change. You will notice in the attitude of the world, things never change. And to that, we Christians will say, well, we know people don't change. But we believe God changes people, and God is mighty to save. I've met some people who are really good at acting in loving ways, but maybe they're not so good about sharing about Jesus. I've met others, probably the majority, who are really good about saying things, whether good or bad, about Jesus, but then not so good at acting in the loving ways. The truth is, we need both. And by the way, I just want to preface this and say, saying positive things about Jesus does not mean that we're sugarcoating the truth. Nobody's asking us to sugarcoat the truth. That's not what we should be doing. Remember 1 John here, how he's written this letter, inspired of God. He says, dear children, he says it with love. There's a lot you can learn, even from one verse. But then, he tells them what not to do, doesn't he? You like being told what not to do? I don't. That's what John is doing. He says, let us not. And yet, somehow when you read that verse, boy, it's not really coming across as hate speech, is it? Let us not love with words of speech. So he's not sugarcoating. He's really not. I'd like to tell you just a little story. It's a true story from my life. I was hesitant to share it, but I find myself in a pastoral position where I believe it's right before the Lord to tell you. A group of my friends, this happened a couple years ago, they got together and they wanted to go confront this young man who they heard was very cruel to his girlfriend. Their friend, and also at that time, that was a friend of mine. And so this man's mistake, he mistreated this woman. It was not abuse, it was not violence, but we're talking about a person who was pretty cold. So they all got together and decided, well, I don't know, they're going to like march into his apartment and, you know, bust down his door and just really give him a mouthful, that kind of thing. So we talked it over and I don't know, I said, you guys, just let me go talk to him first. You know, in this kind of situation, here's the truth. I felt in my heart that, my friends were kind of thinking about this situation in the wrong way. Right? They were going about this in a vindictive sort of way. You know, I felt that while it's true, he most likely has done a bad thing. Well, we Christians we should address this situation in a different manner. We shouldn't sugarcoat the wrongs, but act with grace. And once again, let me just give glory to God in this moment that only the Spirit of Jesus could lead my own heart to behave in such a way, so it's no boast. Well, so we get to the apartment, and going up the stairs, knock on the door, he's home, I enter the room with him, and there he is, he's kind of sitting in this central chair, and, you know, I just start talking to him in a normal tone, you know, not coming at him, but just saying, hey, everybody's been saying this about you, and this is not a good situation, that's what they believe, and just, you know, what's going on? And he was not my friend at the time, I didn't really know him, but... So he just kind of starts telling me about his life and what happened with his girlfriend at that time and those sorts of things. And just he began to tell me some of the cold ways that he had treated her. So, you know, I said, you know, Jesus calls us to live differently. And it was this man-to-man thing. And, you know, I know it applies to women as well, but just talking to him, I was telling him, you know, Jesus calls us. Man to man, we got to pick up our cross and we got to do the tough thing, even when it's the right thing, even when it's tough. Jesus calls us to a better way, and the way that you are behaving, you know, it was not right. It's not what Jesus calls us to do as people, as men, you know, as boyfriends, spouses. And, you know, to my shock, this guy, he just starts crying. He just starts weeping right in front of me, and he says, I want to give my life to Jesus. You know, I mean, just wow. And I'm getting goosebumps right now. I said, you know, can I pray with you? And right there, he gave his life to Jesus. It's a completely different outcome than it could have been. I went and I told the friends. I just couldn't believe it, but the fact of the matter is, this man, well, he was truly sorry for what he had done, and it was evident. And Jesus worked a miracle in that moment. Well, I was thinking about all this, and I was reminded of the old prophet's words from Zephaniah 3:17. Maybe you know this verse. It says, the Lord your God is in your midst. A mighty one who will save. He will save when we follow him, when we listen to him. In fact, he will rejoice over you with gladness. Not only will it be a loud celebration, but he will quiet you by his love. He will even sing over you. Our God sings over you. This is the one of whom the prophet spoke, whom the elder John, in his life, grew to love and do life with and walk with in person. He is Jesus Christ our Lord. Although John, the son of thunder, was the one changed by God's love, well, Jesus is the one who does the transforming work. Jesus works this in you and me. Jesus accomplishes this through the cross. Jesus accomplishes this by being raised to life by the power of the Spirit. Honest to God, how would you have responded? You know, if you learned your friend, your girlfriend, how about your daughter, your child, was treated harshly or unkindly? You know, would you just come in swinging and rain down wrath? Or would you speak life, speak the truth in love? Because this is all about Jesus. The truth is that by grace we all have a choice. We have a chance to choose love. Jesus teaches our behavior flows from who we are. Talked about that last week. But in fact that Jesus makes us Christ-like. We call that sanctification. So that our actions and decisions enabled by grace begin to look more and more like Jesus. And Jesus, he makes choosing love possible when we believe. By amazing grace, the Spirit of God enables us to choose him, choose to make this world a better place. I want to conclude with this word today. You know, I started off by saying that some of us, I imagine, even right now, are just dying to hear that word. The approval, the I'm proud of you, my son. The I love you, my daughter, from mom or dad. And I would even imagine that maybe some of you have lived your whole life trying to prove it to mom or prove it to dad, even when they may have passed on already, and you're still trying to prove it. Can I tell you just to let it go? Just to give it to Jesus. You know, you can just let it go. I know it's not easy. I'm saying it's only possible through Jesus. God says of you, this is my son, this is my daughter, with whom I am well pleased. Jesus is the pool of grace you have been waiting for, who died for you. I'm saying the water is just fine over here with me. It's going to be okay. Folks, when we receive the Lord's freedom, His eternal word of love in our hearts, you know, very soon, our brothers and sisters and our dear children in need everywhere, well, God opens our eyes to see them and speak the same loving word into their lives. Won't you pray with me today? Jesus, we thank you for who you are today. Lord, I feel led to just pray a special prayer for somebody who may be hurting without you. God, who may be looking for that approval from a human, from mom or dad, that feels like they could just never live up or be worthy of their pride, their joy, their love. Lord, in this moment, I just pray that by grace, they would just give it to you and just let it go, Jesus, because you are enough. Jesus, you are enough for us. You are sufficient for every need that we have. Lord, you are the great provider and the protector. You are a refuge to whom we can run during times of trouble. And Lord, your love never fails. Be the king of our heart, Lord. Let us not go on living in some other mission, but let us be committed to seeking first you and your kingdom righteousness. And everything else is added to it so that we don't have to live like that anymore. Lord Jesus, help us to turn it around and spread it. Help us to turn around and speak love in the world. Speak love to a desperate society, nation in need of gospel truth in loving ways, commensurate with our actions, so that we don't have an integrity problem. We don't have a hypocrisy problem. We just have a problem of, well, who else can we love? Who else can we bless? Jesus, thank you for your mighty, powerful word and what you're doing, even right now, in the heart of somebody who's listening. Bless them, Lord Jesus. Cover them with your grace, your mercy, and lift them up from the pit. We're going to thank you for what you do, Jesus. It's in your mighty, powerful name we pray. God's people say, amen.
Will you stand with us, please, and sing a closing song? Pastor Mike talked about sharing with his friend running to Christ. Sometimes, all we can do is just a little encouraging word, and it's a seed planted. Maybe just tell somebody, hey, I'm just thinking about you, I'm praying about you. Maybe we want to tell somebody, good job. Do some of those small things. Amen. That's very small. I'm
so much. Well, you know, I heard around here, prior to my pastoring, in fact, here at Southwood, every fifth Sunday of the month, when that occurs, is a mission Sunday. And well, I had a little bit of disagreement on that, but whatever the case may be, I want to say, why not begin to let the floodgates open with what Jesus wants to do? Right? Why not? And so, to that end, I prepared just this new closing word for us from Scripture, so you can just receive it in this awareness of what Jesus has for you, a living plan for your life, and to share it with actions and words everywhere. It's from Colossians 3:16 and 17. It says, "Let the message of Christ dwell among you richly, as you teach and admonish one another, with all wisdom through psalms, hymns, and through songs from the Spirit, singing to God with gratitude in your hearts. And whatever you do, whether it's in word or deed, do it all in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks to God the Father through Him." Amen? Why don't we sing before we go?
Let's sing praise to God from whom all blessings flow.
Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise Him, all creatures every hold. Praise Him, all love ye heavenly hosts. Praise Father, Son, and Holy
peace. We hope to see you next week. God bless you.
Thank you.